We have previously derived the optimal base filter. It's only in a few special cases that there is a closed form solution, and in other cases we have to apply numerical approximations. And today we are going to see one classical solution to this called the point mass filter. So the key idea in a point mass filter is to grid the state space and evaluate the base optimal filter on this gridded state space. We will derive the filter and its implementation and also show some numerical examples. Let's first recapitulate the models used in nonlinear filtering. So we are working from physical relations with state space models of this form. But in this context of the point mass filter, we prefer to denote the models by its conditional probability density functions. And the optimal base filter can be stated by this recursion. So we update the posterior density for the state given old measurements according to this integral here, which is a function of the filtering state. And the filtering state is updated according to the measurement update, where you multiply the previously time-updated predictive density multiplied by the likelihood and normalized by this normalizing factor, which does not have to be evaluated in practice. So as said, the analytical solution is only available in a few special cases, like the Kalman filter. What we're going to do today is to evaluate these two recursions on a given trajectory and then compare different trajectories to each other by comparing their likelihood or their weight. So we're going to update the weights for possible trajectories. So the key idea is to approximate the filtering and posterior density functions by p hat here as the weighted sum of particles. So we assume that we have a grid point of a state space called xk of I. We apply this kind of Dirac impulse density at this point and let it have an associated weight. So different points in the state space have different weights. And if we sum up all these particles, then we get a proper density function that integrates to one. And if we have this kind of representation of the this case predictive density, we can evaluate the first two moments. So the mean can be seen as the minimum mean square estimate of the state. So we take the expected value of this sum here, and the expected value of the Dirac functions is just the grid point xk of I. So the mean is easy to evaluate. And the covariance is also quite easy to evaluate by just plugging in the definition. And it's again a weighted sum of the spread of the grid points around the expected value. And in some cases also the map estimate is useful. That is just considering the maximum weight over the predicted density. So the question is now how to update this predictive and filtering density approximation. So measurement update turns out to be quite straightforward. So we assume that we have the weights from the time update given already. And we have to multiply by the likelihood function, which is easy to evaluate for a given grid point. We just plug in this xki in the sensor model we have, and we get out the real number here. When we have done that for all particles, we can compute this normalization factor, guaranteed that the sum is a proper density function, so it integrates to one. So measurement update is straightforward. Time update is a bit more tricky, but not so much. Okay, so let's look at what we have already. We have computed the weights from the measurement update. We have the motion model that tells us how the next state will evolve given the current state. So this can also be evaluated for each xk plus 1. And our new approximation for the predictive density is the weighted sum of these terms. Now the question is, which xk plus 1 should we consider to get this closed form recursion alive? Yes, if we reuse the grid we had from before, so we evaluate this on the grid we already have defined, then it turns out that we keep this recursive form of the Bayesian optimal filter. So that means that the new weight for the time update is the probability for each grid point I here. So we have to consider the transition from each grid point xk of j to each grid point xk plus 1 of I. So every grid point can transition to every grid point again. And we can already here note that we get a quadratic complexity because we have n square possible combinations here in the sum. So let's illustrate with an example, and you have seen this example several times before in the first part of the course. So we assume that we have one radar, and the radar has a good range resolution and a poor angle resolution. So what you will see here is our prior distribution, so we have to start somewhere, so we define this uniform grid over x and y space. So actually each pixel here is one grid point in the state space. That's important to remember. Then you also see a green rhomb here, which is the ground truth. We have the magenta, which is the estimate. In this case, the center of gravity of all grid points, which is in the middle. So this is our prior distribution at time one. This is what happens when we get the first measurement. So the first measurement happens to be here. We get this banana shape of the filtering density. You remember from the first part that when we evaluated the loss function for the non-linearly squares criteria, we got this kind of banana shape. And this yellow part actually looks like a banana. So you can also see this as a numerical solution to the non-linearly squares problem, but now embedded in a filtering context. So after the measurement update, we get an estimate that is very close to the measurement, which happens to be, in this case, quite far away from the ground truth, but that depends on the big value of the noise in this realization that is far away from the ground truth. Now we come to the time update, so we increase this index one step here. And the time update for a constant position motion model just says that we increase the uncertainty in all directions. So this banana-shaped filtering density now looks more like an ellipsoid. The ground truth has moved from time one to time two, but we haven't seen that yet. But when we get a new measurement, we get a new filtering density here, which happens to go in the wrong direction. So we are a bit unlucky again here with the noise realization, because the ground truth moves to the right while our measurement moves to the left. Let's proceed. New time update and the new measurement update. Now the measurement happens to be on the right side of this banana, so our estimate moves to the right, which is correct. New time update, new measurement update, and we see that we continue to follow this banana. And new measurement shows that we consistently seem to move to the southeast. And one final measurement update until we leave this simulation. And we can compare this magenta estimate of the position with the ground truth, which happens to be a straight line here. So to summarize this example, to get some take-home messages, So first I mentioned that the measurement update works as a numerical non-linear least squares solver. So you get the peak of the banana in a numerical way. For this two-dimensional state vector with a 40 times 40 grid, there are 1,600 weights. And these weights are quickly updated on the computer, so it doesn't take any time. As you notice, the target moved, and after a while it will move outside the grid. So there is clearly a need to adapt the grid to the moving target. And that's an implementational challenge, how to move the grid, and maybe also to refine the grid. The more information you get, you start with a sparse grid and get the finer grid after a while. The trajectory we estimated was not so nice looking, but that depends on that we didn't have any velocity state in the model. If we add the velocity state, then of course we will get a smoother trajectory. But if you add velocity, you have a four-dimensional state vector. So assume that we have 40 times 40 velocity states as well. That means that we have 40 raised to the power of 4 grid points. That is 2.56 million grid points. It's still feasible to run this in MATLAB, but as you will figure out, the complexity increases quite quickly with the state dimension. The particle filter that we will see later mitigates this exponential growth in complexity somewhat and includes an adaptive grid. The point mass filter is still quite useful in some applications compared to the particle filter, and I will show one such application here on the next slide. So this is real data from a collaboration with the FOI, where the goal is to track vehicles on a road segment using two microphone arrays. On the black points here, we have microphone arrays with four microphones at each point, and they approximate the direction of arrival of the engine sound from the vehicles. And we have two vehicles here, the green dots, coming from each direction, and they will meet somewhere here. And again, there is no motion model, only one state for the position. And since we assume that the vehicles follow the road, it's a one-dimensional state space. So we just have to add grid points on the road here, and we define a grid point to cover 1 meter of the road each. Okay, we start the animation here, and we can see that the grid points forms kind of Gaussian distribution around each vehicle. When they meet, they sum up, so we can't distinguish them for a while, but once they are separated, we get two kind of modes of the posterior. To sum up, the point mass filter has a few advantages. It's simple to implement. It works excellently for small state spaces, preferably less than 2. It gives the complete posterior, not only an estimate and a covariance compared to the extended Kalman filter for the same problem. And it's a global search on the defined grid, so we don't get stuck in a local minima, as was the risk for nonlinear least squares. But there are several problems. The grid is inefficient in high dimensions, since the probability of to get to one grid point depends on the transition probability from all other grid points, so we have to consider all possible moves from one grid point to the next one. The grid should be adaptive. If the target is moving, then the grid also has to be moving. And when we get more information, we should have a finer grid. And there's a quadratic complexity in the number of grid points, which is maybe the real bottleneck of the point mass filter. Reading advice is sections 9.1 to 9.2.